Welcome to the TMBS 6 p.m. live stream. We keep doing more stuff for all you great people. We don't do these every week, but we've been doing them more and more because we have so many great people and so many important conversations we need to have. So we have the extremely illustrious 6 p.m. slot joining us. Hit us with a YouTube super chat. Help us keep the channel growing. Joining us is one of the most interesting people on YouTube, a pioneer of the YouTube video essay, Peter Coffin. Peter, thanks so much for being here.
Well, thank you for having me.
It's my great pleasure. Peter, I talked to Zizek, as patrons know, about the Joker for about 3 or 4 minutes. but we're going to go deeper into it. I maintain my tradition of talking about movies that I have not seen and probably won't ever see. But you had a very fascinating pro-Joker case that I recommend everybody see. What is the Joker telling us?
Well, the Joker is more or less, first off, the Joker himself is telling us, I would say his ultimate position is that of total acceptance of the sort of overtly neoliberal capitalist sort of very austerity-oriented world that he lives in. He sort of accepts that ideology through the course of the film. And I think that a lot of people miss this. While this entire thing that's going on throughout the course of the film, where there is a sort of collective uproar about the ruling class of this city, both private and public, like for instance, the city is cutting the budget for mental health services while these billionaires are going on TV calling all of the people who are rising up clowns. As this stuff is happening, he's sort of just going further and further into himself, more and more doing what gives him catharsis in this world. And as it turns out, that ends up being more and more violent as the world becomes more and more violent. It's a very interesting movie because it doesn't do a lot to tell you exactly what it's trying to say, but it depicts a world that I think is very brutal and slightly exaggerated, but not entirely unlike ours. And I think that the Joker himself sort of embodies a sort of acceptance of the ideology of the film as a, or not the film, but the film's world. And I think that a lot of people who ended up saying, like, don't say the Joker is a leftist. Like, why? I don't think that anybody really is saying the Joker is a leftist. I got that quite a bit in response. And like, my video is called Joker, the Culture War and Pure Ideology. And it's utterly not like I call him the villain. I say that he's basically accepting this very, very individualistic, very nihilistic view of the world that the world is trying to beat into him. And that's where he gets to by the end of the film. I don't think he's the hero, a leftist, or anything like that. But I do think the film depicts a very specific class situation that helps us maybe look at our world slightly differently.
Yeah, I could think of one maybe not entirely sharp aspiring clown that seemed to think the Joker was a bit leftist. But that's a conversation for another day and a more ideas-heavy episode. But Peter, Peter, that's what I think is fascinating is that visually, just even watching the ad for the film, and I've seen some, you know, some cuts of it on YouTube and so on, just to kind of get a sense of it. Even though I'm, you know, and of course I've watched your commentary, the filmmaking technique and the casting of De Niro and even kind of Joaquin Phoenix's style as an actor. I mean, it does seem like an homage to the kind of like, you know, I mean, the obvious one is Taxi Driver, but even like Mean Streets and so on. But what I thought was interesting,
a very big influence on it as well.
I thought, what did you say?
I said, I think King of Comedy is a pretty big influence on it as well. Just basically, that whole Scorsese era, I think, is a big, really holds a lot over it, more or less.
Absolutely. But what I thought was interesting from watching your commentary was sort of like, stylistically and in terms of homage, but the sort of hyper neoliberalization. I mean, maybe the kind of, you know, stylistically 70s New York, but the policy sets and Wall Street mindset is pure 2019.
Oh, absolutely. I mean, you did see the beginnings of that sort of in the 70s and 80s, but obviously it came to its culmination in 2008, and where we've sort of landed in our world as it is now. That movie, we can't sit here and say, is not about now. It is about now. There are a lot of anachronistic elements to it. There's some film tropes, for instance, that they subvert, like Arthur Fleck, the person who eventually becomes the Joker, actually shows empathy for some kids that beat him up, whereas if it was a film that had been created in the time period it's depicting, it probably would have depicted those kids as, because they were, I would say, diverse. They were a couple of black people, a couple of Hispanic people. They probably would have depicted that as, let's say, less than empathetically. There might not be a reason why these kids, but he says they're just kids, and he basically sort of is like, this is basically what this. He has some sort of an understanding at the beginning of the film that this city creates a world that these people are all living in, and these just kids are living in this sort of hyper-competitive, hyper-individualistic, show-strength-type world. And to dismiss that is very anachronistic, in my opinion, of the original film, or not the original film, the original era of films that it's sort of playing homage to. And in sort of depicting the ideologies we see on display today, much more descriptively than, and this is, I think, really where people, I think, have trouble with the film. It's not really saying, like, you have to do this or you have to take this out of it. It's a very descriptive film rather than prescriptive.
Right.
And what it ends up doing, I think, is when I came away from it, I was like, there are going to be a lot of people that look at our world and go, you know what? They really do treat poor people or mentally ill people or so on and so forth like shit, more or less. Like there's a reason for that, and I might want to think about the reason for that. And it's not necessarily holding your hand all the way through that, but there's so many circumstances in this film that if you add them up, you eventually come to the point where it's kind of saying, like, this neoliberal mode is bad and class consciousness would be good. Not necessarily so easily that you might just walk away from it saying that to somebody else if you haven't been primed in any way for it. But I do think that it's there.
What do you make of the general reaction to it? I thought it was really interesting. There was, I think, a handful of people on the right that tried to say, you know, see, this is Antifa or whatever kind of silliness.
Yeah.
And then
they really
was,
did try to do that. Too.
They did. No, I definitely, that was, they look, B plus for effort on that one. I can't give an A. I've seen much more effective right wing hysteria than that. But there was a lot of kind of liberal hand wringing about it. And one thing that's interesting, you know, is always the sort of like, you know, the spasms of anxiety about cultural products when, you know, we're already in it, right? Like, we already do have people engaging in mass murder on a relatively regular basis across the United States. We certainly have an awe-inspiring amount of pain and alienation in addition to all of the material suffering and inequality. And, you know, it really struck me in a couple of ways. One was, you know, this kind of almost magical notion that's like, oh man, if you remind these alienated young men that they're having a bad time, that's going to be dangerous. It's like, well,
yeah.
I don't know they need to be reminded. And number secondly, I think that this is related, a bit disconnected, but I think the dynamic you identified of someone who's essentially on the receiving end of all of these systems, there's a couple of different ways you can go. And one extremely understandable way, and obviously it doesn't need to be remotely as, you know, it doesn't need to be the Joker. I mean, one thing, the last thing that came to mind was the fascinating documentary, Paris is Burning, that came out in the 80s, that documented these transgender communities and other communities in the Bronx and Harlem in the 1980s, when, you know, it was under, you know, it was pre-terrorized Giuliani, Bloomberg, New York. A lot of poverty, a lot of racism. Then, of course, the whole gender and sexual identity dimension. And all of the, a lot of the vogues and competitions they did involved mimicking and replicating movies like Dallas, or TV shows like Dallas, the most, high-end, materially and racially, the royal family. So this dynamic of somebody who, or communities that are totally beaten down, wanting to basically gain psychological dignity in some respects by succeeding in oppressive cultures terms, that is actually a very common and very important dynamic to understand.
Oh, absolutely. When we start to, like I said, when we start to look at the film from the idea that Joker himself, Arthur Fleck, the character, actually himself accepts the idea. Because, okay, so the reason why I say this is because there's two events in this film where he, and these are spoilers. Is it all right to say spoilers?
Oh, God, please. Everybody watching, I assume, is an adult.
Okay. Yes. All right. There's a point in the film where he kills three Wall Street guys, and then not long after, the first two are self-defense, and the last one is certainly sort of catharsis, like, I fought back, I screwed these guys who have screwed me my whole life, these rich people have been more or less sucking up all of this, all of the resources, all of the money, and this city comes down on me instead of them. So there's an element of self-defense that turns into catharsis. And then later, he goes to a social worker, his social worker, who is doing therapy with him. And during the course of it, she says she reveals to him that they've cut the budget. He's not going to have his medication anymore. He's not going to be able to come there for therapy anymore, so on and so forth. She says, they don't give a shit about people like you, Arthur, and they don't give a shit about people like me. And right here, he's presented the choice of either aligning with his own catharsis and therefore eventually accepting the ideology that he has today, the ideology that the world presents him with today, or this person presents him with a message of a slightly pessimistic sounding message of struggle. Now, accepting that version would have meant rejecting the ideology of the world of the film. However, he doesn't. He instead moves forward with it and continues to eventually land in this killing, in this sort of brutal, I am bringing the consequences to you type of same thing, but from the other end type, actions would be the way to put it. And ultimately, there's a good reason, I think, why people do that, which is what you were alluding to. It sort of proves to the world that you're not crap, you're not nothing. Right. And it's sort of like a reaction to, like, this idea that you're not supposed to succeed within this ideology. Yeah. It's very much a choice we're faced with today, too. We're faced with that individual catharsis of success in the brutal ideology we're presented with, or this semi-not-great-sounding, kind of difficult thing of collective struggle. And, you know, we're given that choice, not necessarily by the power structure itself. If it was left to its own devices, we pretty much would only be presented with the go down the try to be a success by the standards of the world path. But that's basically, I think, what this film sort of does to undermine capitalist realism in the viewer is sort of presenting them with that choice. And it sucks in some ways because a lot of people need to be told, like, this is the right choice and this is the wrong choice, and it doesn't do that. And a lot of people sort of responded with, well, it's too vague. I think that, like, there's potential for it to have a leftist message, but it doesn't say it. And that kind of, it's not great, but I also think just simply presenting the viewer with that choice, even if it's not the most obvious thing in the world, helps in some way.
Yeah, well, I mean, it's also, it's, you know, it's art. You can't.
Yeah,
and I think
exactly.
Reflective of, I mean, I'm actually, it's funny. I'll do another, I hope this connects, but I mean, first of all, each and every one of us are caught in between contradictions. But even somebody like, you know, one of the reasons that I think Tupac Shakur is an adoringly fascinating cultural figure for people is because mm-hmm. his art and his communication, and by the way, particularly at a time when it was not fashionable and it was not trendy to be political, he was mm-hmm. extremely political. And extremely rigorous and insightful. And he was also absolutely a glorifier of violence and so on.
Mm-hmm.
That is both true. And I think that, you know, people need to, from all quadrants, need to deal much more with the kind of mix and ambiguity. And if the movie pulled that off, then that's a success. But I think what I got from you, though, was the replication. And so in that sense...
Yes.
He's not really such a rebel at the end of the day. Like so many kind
no.
of quote unquote, he kind of at the end sort of reminded me of like Richard Branson on crack or something. So like bizarro world, Richard Branson.
Well, yeah, I mean, you land with him sort of in this position of like, what's the best way to put it? He is an embodiment of the world by the end of the film. And that's the thing that I think it's hard to grapple with, but like the world that we live in today, the real world, is extremely violent. It's to pretend that the systemic violence perpetrated on our own citizens here, whether it be through class or by race, systemically, if we ignore that stuff and pretend that this world is not violent, but accept that all of the things that go on outside of our country are just some sort of aberration, then what we're really doing is we're allowing ourselves to embody a contradiction that I think that Arthur Fleck, the Joker, by the end of this film, just absolutely does not. He embraces the world as a systemically violent place, and in order to challenge that, but not necessarily actually to challenge it. In his mind, he's challenging. He's sort of competing with it instead of actually trying to subvert or end anything. In his mind, he's challenging it by simply being violent back.
Right. In the last couple of minutes, and of course we will be talking more, but could you bring in... You mentioned it before. I've certainly talked about it on the show, but in the last couple of minutes, could you synchronize this with your understanding of Mark Fisher's work on capitalist realism?
Well, I would almost say that the best way to even bring capitalist realism in here is to even just talk about, again, that choice I brought up, where he's presented with an alternative and basically totally ignores it. The way that presentation goes down, his social worker says something that is class conscious. She's, you know, of a totally different like position. Like she's a black woman. She's a professional. He's unemployed. Like they don't have a lot to relate, like specifically as individuals. However, as far as class goes, they do. And when she says this, they don't give a shit about you and they don't give a shit about me, that's a very specific, hey, they is a thing and we are a thing. And the way that he reacts to that is just, it's completely capitalism. He doesn't see that. He doesn't he just thinks that, and a lot of I would even go as far to say as a lot of the people who discounted this film went ahead and saw it exactly as he did, which is this person is kind of in my way. This person is denying me mental health care and my medication because they're a representative of this system, and they're trying to get me off their back by trying to relate to me. And that's not what is going on here at all. It's an actual, like, genuine, maybe not comfortable, but it is a choice presented to him and presented again to the audience. And a lot of people, both the Joker and a lot of the film critics who try to present these people as obstacles to the Joker, to Arthur Fleck, sort of take that capitalist realism. This, there are no alternatives to capitalism. This is a hierarchical system in which I have a position, you have a position, and the ruling class is justified in their much higher position than myself. This stuff all makes sense to me. And what you're bringing to me when you say this, we, who I ostensibly can find no real connection between us, it seems like you're never listening to me, it seems like you don't have any solutions for me, we don't have a lot in common, so you must not really be trying to reach me. And ultimately, that wall between them is a perfect symbolization of what capitalist realism is, which is, again, in the subtitle of the book, there are no alternatives to capitalism. It is like this. Stuck this way forever.
Peter Coffin, thanks a million. This was fascinating. You were the only person that could make a Joker conversation happen on this show besides Slavoj Žižek. Everybody check out Peter's work. Fascinating, really, like, essays, feature-length essays. He's one of the most interesting people you can watch. Peter, thank you so much. I really appreciate it.
No, thank you.
All right, folks, we will be back here live in about 35 minutes or so with Shahid Buttar and Richard Wolff, Lula finally free, Bolivia coup, and much, much more. Thanks, everybody.